This is episode 89 of the Death to Tyrants podcast.
The crushing weight of the tyrant's passage had left nothing unmarked.
You get split in fucking half, but I call him the hologram wrath. But I am the center inside the placenta of math. You clash with cyanide gas and die fast. Rhythmical equivalent of solids, liquid and gas. We smash your sinus with the power of Lord Titus. But I am the virus inside of the iris of Cyrus.
What's up, you guys? Welcome back once again to the Death to Tyrants podcast. As always, I am your host and still your humble narrator, Buck Johnson, coming to you out of Austin, Texas. Today, I'm stoked. I've got Michael Bolden, the founder of the 10th Amendment Center, on the show. And the reason I invited Michael to come on is I wanted to discuss all of the stuff that's going on in Virginia right now. And, you know, and the broader topic of gun control, the movement that's unfortunately being pushed upon us in basically every state, especially at the federal level as well, and its opposition, the gun rights movement. Why is all of this noise being made in Virginia all of a sudden? There's been draconian gun laws on the books basically in every state. I know there's some in Virginia, and at the federal level, we all know about it. Why now? Why was this march happening last week? What are they fighting against? What is all of this stuff in regards to sanctuary cities and counties, Second Amendment sanctuary cities and counties? What do they mean? Does it have any actual power? Is that something that's actually going to fight state and federal tyranny? So none better to discuss all of this stuff than Michael Bolden, because you guys know what they do over there at the 10th Amendment Center. You better know. And if you don't know, you will after you hear our discussion. And of course, I will link to the 10th Amendment Center in the show notes page for this episode. Let's not waste any more time. Let's get Michael on the show. Michael Bolden, director and founder of the great 10th Amendment Center. Welcome to Death to Tyrants.
Awesome. Thanks for having me on.
You got it. I want to get into this stuff that went on in Virginia and kind of the macro picture, really, even outside of Virginia with gun rights and quote unquote sanctuary counties and cities. But before we get into that stuff, I like to give my listeners a baseline knowledge on my guest and their expertise. So could you start here with talking about what you do and the mission over there at the 10th Amendment Center?
Yeah, I run an organization called 10th Amendment Center. We're over at 10thamendmentcenter.com, all spelled out, if you don't mind me plugging that. But we work to do two main things. One, we educate people on the proper role of government under the federal constitution as passed by the Philadelphia Convention and ratified by the people of the several states. And then the second thing we do beyond education is we work to activate people to undermine, reject, resist, and nullify basically anything and everything that's unconstitutional. And if we were to actually compare that to the original Constitution, if you just basically picked out 9 out of 10 things the federal government has done in modern times, you could have a knee-jerk reaction and say it's all unconstitutional. So there's a lot of things to do. We want to set the foundation for liberty, whether in our lifetime or somewhere down the line in the future.
You've also got a new podcast, or maybe not so new, but I've just recently discovered it, right? And The Path to Liberty. And I'm stoked to have found it. I don't know why it took me so long, seeing that you've got episodes back early on, 2018, I believe it said.
It's almost 2 years. And I'm not really good at, I actually started it as kind of an off-the-cuff YouTube live stream. I have all kinds of video gear. I shoot, I've done short 3 to 5 minute videos on various issues for a long time. And I'm like, man, I should just start live streaming. I'm spending a lot of time on YouTube myself, and I could just start talking about stuff. And I just started doing that. And it kind of caught on. And after a while, I decided, you know, I should do a podcast edition. I should stream on multiple channels. And it's just been growing and growing and growing. We're not huge by any stretch of the imagination. When I first started, we'd get about 150 viewers or listeners. And one of my episodes that I did last month in December of 2019 on Virginia, these so-called Second Amendment sanctuaries, got somewhere around 20, 25,000. That's not normal. That's on the high end. But we're definitely reaching a lot more people.
Excellent. That is on the high end. That's good.
It's super cool. Yeah, that's not the norm of what happens here, but it's definitely growing.
Well, tell my listeners, what can you expect? What can they expect from the Path to Liberty podcast?
It's basically what I was talking about as the structure of the organization that I run. We want to educate people, and then we want to get them active. Because we can read a zillion Rothbard books all day long, but that in and of itself, the knowledge in and of itself doesn't change things. So I think, and it wasn't originally called Path to Liberty, but I learned somebody else was doing a podcast in Tennessee with a different name that I had at the time and decided to change it to make it easy. Yeah. And, but I thought about it. I'm like, this is really what my work is all about and has been for over a decade, is teaching people how to get from point A to point B. Well, actually like point Z. If we want to accomplish liberty, and we really follow Thomas Jefferson's ideal that the ground of liberty, and this is how he put it, the ground of liberty is to be gained by inches. Like the status, the people who love the monster state, they've been clawing away for more and more power over time. We didn't get to the largest government, the largest military empire on the face of the earth in the history of the globe overnight. It's taken well over a century, and their strategies have been very good. And if we think about that, and also what Jefferson had recommended, we have to take every little step that we can and claw back. And again, that's why I talk about we're going to set the foundation for liberty, whether in our lifetime or sometime in the future. Personally, I believe that turning around a $23 trillion national debt and a military that has a presence in 150 plus countries isn't going to happen overnight. And anyone who promises that, promises some kind of silver bullet, I think they're lying to you, or they're just maybe ignorant of what we're really facing.
Right, right. Well, let's get to this situation in Virginia. Obviously, as of late, there's been a groundswell of Second Amendment support there. Not that it wasn't there already, but it seems like we're hearing a lot about this stuff in the news, the gun rights movement there. Why is this happening now? And is this a response to something that's going on there?
Wow, that is an awesome set of questions, because there's a lot that we could go like three different directions with it. Why is it happening now? I guess that's one of the questions that I have. Why is it happening now, and why didn't it happen last summer or the year before or the decade before? Because there has been gun control on the books on both the federal and the state level. If we're talking Article 1, Section 13 of the Virginia State Constitution, thanks to people like the great George Mason. It is really even better than the Second Amendment to the federal Constitution on the right to keep and bear arms. Maybe someone would argue with me on that, but it's pretty awesome. There have been gun control measures on the books, both on the state and the federal level, for a long time. For the feds, we can go all the way back to 1934, maybe earlier if someone can correct me, National Firearms Act, the 1968 Gun Control Act, its amendments in 1986, the Undetectable Firearms Act of 1988, the Trump bump stock ban of 2018. There's tons of gun control that has been on the books. Why is it only happening now? And that's part of what makes me cynical about this effort in Virginia. I'm hopeful, but very cynical, because if they didn't oppose gun control for so long, but then suddenly once the Democrats take control of the state government for the first time in decades, all of a sudden this is a big issue. This tells me that they might be as partisan and untrustworthy as the anti-war movement was when Bush was in office, and it melted away when the so-called peace president came in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been talking a lot about that on here too, that the left anti-war movement just kind of vanished, didn't it, in 2008?
It's starting to come back now that the Republican is in the White House again. But
right.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate. There are some people, I think, on the left, there are serious leftists, progressives, that I would probably disagree with on almost everything economically, but that have been legitimate anti-war people all along. Mm-hmm. Cindy Sheehan is one of those people. She's been anti-war. She's opposed to the corporate, she'll call them the corporate Democrats, the Hillarys, the warmongers, the Bidens,
yes,
things like that. But it's a small percentage. And the same thing, I think, is on the right to keep and bear arms on the right. So many people think that Donald Trump is the Second Amendment president, and I'm sorry to chuckle at this, but this is one of the biggest lies, the biggest shams that people are falling for. And I think they're only falling for it because they're ignorant of what's going on. He's actually put into place more gun control than Obama did. So I know he's lately been kind of going after the horrible gun grabber governor of Virginia, this guy Northam, the blackface dude, right?
Yeah.
And Trump has been going after him saying, oh, I would never let anyone attack our Second Amendment rights. As a side note, I hate the phrase Second Amendment rights.
Yes.
If you talk about it as your rights are based on words in a document, then the people who interpret that document can take them away. Mm-hmm. We have to really kind of think, I believe we really have to focus on our natural right to keep and bear arms, which exist whether there's a constitution or a bill of rights or yes. a Second Amendment or not. We all are born with that right. That's our birthright. So that's just a quick side note. But Trump has been talking about this. And of course, he instituted this new bump stock ban in a way that the Obama administration actually looked at and said, oh, no. We don't actually have the authority to do this. So in some ways, he's actually worse wow. than the gun grabber Obama. So this kind of political theater of right versus left is a real problem. But if we want to focus more on what's going on in the response, there's these, like 100 or so Second Amendment sanctuaries, localities that are claiming to be sanctuaries in Virginia. And I have some issues with that if you want to talk about it.
I do, yeah, because I've heard you mention, and it really helped me clarify the issue, that you don't like that term, quote unquote, sanctuary city or county in this instance.
I mean, I love the term. I love the concept. But I don't like it when local governments, and this might be just redundant, but when governments claim to be something they're not. So someone is either lying about being a Second Amendment sanctuary in all 100 of them, or they're so ignorant that they shouldn't be trusted in the first place. Because first of all, if you understand what a sanctuary is, obviously people are doing this because they're trying to take the immigration sanctuary city model and flip the switch. Now, this is something I have been arguing for years. I first started talking about it back in around 2009 at the 25th Annual Gun Rights Policy Conference, where I gave a speech talking about it. I didn't actually use the term sanctuary, but I did start using it somewhere 3 to 5 years ago, saying that localities and states should create gun rights sanctuaries and look at why so many conservatives are so pissed off about immigration sanctuaries. Because none of them would be angry if they weren't actually doing something that had an impact on the federal government's ability to enforce federal immigration law. If they were merely passing things that said, well, we don't like federal immigration law. We think there should be open borders. We don't want anyone to be deported. If they just said that and complained about it and then went and voted or something, no one on the right would ever complain about these things. But the fact of the matter is, now I've read about 200 or so of these so-called sanctuary policies or ordinances on the local level for immigration. And almost all of them, what they do, and depends on the city, like San Francisco is the most commonly known one. They have the City and County of Refuge Ordinance that's been on the books since 1989. It was last amended in around 2013 when Obama was in office. So that's not a partisan one there. But basically what they do is they prohibit local law enforcement or local agencies of the government from participating or using resources for the enforcement of certain federal immigration laws. Now, whether you agree with that or not, we can all agree that it has a huge impact on federal enforcement capabilities. And the ATF, ICE actually puts out an annual report talking about this every year. And they actually complain about how their local partners aren't helping them out. And it makes it more difficult for them. So we've been urging people to do the same thing in cities and states on gun control for a long time. We've started to see some efforts. Missouri is the most popular where we've seen a Second Amendment Preservation Act or a gun rights sanctuary bill considered. The closest we got was a couple of years ago where it was passed in both houses but ended up not getting to the governor's desk in time to become law. But so far this year for 2020, there is legislation to do this immigration sanctuary thing on the right to keep and bear arms in places like West Virginia, Oklahoma, South Carolina, Missouri. We're expecting others. Now, these resolutions being passed in Virginia, these Second Amendment sanctuary resolutions that are passed in Virginia, they don't do anything. Under state law, and this is the same in almost all of the 50 states, when a locality passes a resolution, it has zero effect. All it is a statement of the opinion of the County Board of Commissioners at the time that it was passed. It holds no impact in law. If you want to stop enforcing something, you have to pass an ordinance. And none of them have done that. But yet they're claiming to have created a sanctuary similar to what's being done on the immigration. I'm not sure if that was really clear because there's a lot to actually kind of digest there.
Yeah, that's interesting. As you were stating that towards the end, it almost reminded me when you're saying the resolution is almost an opinion of the locality, it almost sounds like, you know, it's, hey, today in Los Angeles, it's Michael Bolden Day. We proclaim that, you know, it has no teeth to it,
right.
But I guess it's nice that they can say it. Is it the same thing? I know that there's a resolution in Virginia also to support the formation of militias, I believe it said. Is that basically the same kind of?
All resolutions in Virginia, all of them are non-binding political statements and have no impact of law at all, period. End of story. Every single situation. Now, there has been one, and the interesting thing, as this is kind of ramped up over the last couple of months, almost every headline gets this wrong. I've reached out to a lot of reporters on this. The only one that actually talked to me was just maybe a week or so, was a guy from NBC News who had interviewed me and quoted me in an article in 2018 about similar efforts in Illinois and Oregon. And they actually reported on this pretty fairly. So I talked to NBC recently. We'll see if they actually publish a story on it soon. But yeah, even the militia story, a lot of people are talking. I saw it on Zero Hedge, for example. Oh, a militia's being formed in Virginia to stop the gun control. But this is just a lie. Or someone doesn't know what they're talking about at all. Because what was actually passed, I think it was Tazewell County. I'm just trying to think. Do you know off the top of your hand?
I cannot remember.
I think it was Tazewell County. Basically, they're saying, oh, well, we're going to create a militia. But in fact, they really didn't. All they did was say, well, we're going to add some funding to Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, JROTC, and that's it. No one's creating a militia. They passed a resolution that they support the concept of a militia and that they're going to fund these organizations in order to kind of support that principle. So it's nonsense.
There's a bunch of laws being kind of pushed through in Virginia right now that are anti-gun, so to speak, red flag laws, and what all is going on there as far as the pro-gun control movement?
There's a ton, and they are ramming them through, and I think this should be a warning. First of all, some of the bills that are moving forward, SB 69 and SB 70, I forget which one's which, but these are pieces of legislation that already passed out of the state Senate. One of them passed 21-19. I think that was 69. The other one passed 23-17. That means two Republicans joined in on it. The red flag laws, SB 240. And when do you publish these?
This will go out next Monday, will be the, I believe, 27th. Yeah, Monday,
okay,
the 27th.
So, this is Wednesday the 22nd, and it's likely that they're going to be having a final state Senate vote today or sometime over the next few days on SB 240. Those are three major bills that have already moved. One of them that I've seen covered in a lot of places is an assault weapons ban, SB 16. And this bill was actually pulled out of committee by the request of the sponsor. I don't know specifically why. But a lot of pro-gun people have been touting this as a win. There's all this pressure, these sanctuaries, this rally and lobby day that happened on Martin Luther King Day. All of this pressured them to stop it. They were scared of this. But this is nonsense, because all they did was they filed the exact same bill on the House side. And for those of us who watch state legislatures every single year, and I watch hundreds of bills every single year, most of them are garbage. I would say thousands of bills when you get down to it. Most of them are garbage. And you can see a lot of these parliamentary tricks. You shove some through on one side and then you pull back. And so people kind of turn a blind eye to it. And then all of a sudden you have the exact same bill at the last second and you blast it through. It's House Bill 961. It's an assault weapon ban. Now, one of them that a lot of people are complaining about is a one gun a month ban.
I saw that.
Yeah, and that's pretty crazy if you think about it. But it's not so crazy that Virginia didn't have that law on the books for decades, which I think should give us a little insight as to the nature and the source, the root cause of our problem. Because that one was on the books from like 1990, maybe. My numbers are probably way off on this, but anywhere from like early 90, late 80s to around 2012. And it passed with massive bipartisan support. So like in the state Senate, it was like only four votes against it. And in the House of Republicans, it was a Democrat control by a small margin at the time. I think this was the last time they had it. But Republicans in wide numbers supported this and never opposed it. So no one should be surprised that when even though it ended up getting repealed for a few years, no one should be surprised that if it had so much bipartisan support in the first place and Republicans were horrible on the right to keep and bear arms in the first place, that the Democrats, when they finally get in power, are certainly going to try to just ram it right through again. And here we see it. They're not only trying to implement the same law, but expanding it beyond one handgun, which is what it was originally.
Yeah, God, at this point, it's almost, I mean, are we fighting to stop new gun laws rather than just repealing existing ones? It almost feels like it's a upstream battle here. You're swimming upstream, just trying to stop new ones rather than trying to actually repeal the old ones.
Man, you're telling me. I mean, it's crazy the amount that's on the books. And I think a big part of the problem for the opposition to these laws, and I hate to call them laws because anything that really violates our natural right really shouldn't be seen as a law, but whatever, for lack of a better term. I think that really just exposes one of the big problems. Unless the so-called supporters of the right to keep and bear arms, these Second Amendment supporters, really are consistent and principled, and they don't turn a blind eye to the National Firearms Act because I don't want a machine gun, or they don't turn a blind eye to the bump stock ban because they think it's a kiddie toy and no one should use it, so it's no big deal. As long as they keep doing this, I think we're just going to see more and more and worse gun control year in and year out. And it's worse than fighting upstream. It's going to take people who believe in liberty to really lead the charge, because the people who have been leading the charge are really bad on the right to keep and bear arms. I mean, the National Firearms Act of 34, this is a, you might as well call it the NRA Act of 1934. I don't know if they were involved in the Gun Control Act, but they certainly brag, even in just the last 2 years, on their website about passing, getting the NICS system, the background, the federal national background check system in. And if you always are clawing away at rights and then saying, well, we're just out to get bad guys, you're going to have a real problem. And a lot of the sheriffs in Virginia who have actually been talking about how they're not going to enforce these new gun control laws, one of them actually claimed that he is going to deputize thousands of people.
I saw thousands that. Of
people.
Yeah.
I think his name's Jenkins or something like that. And he said he's going to deputize people. But if you look through a lot of the things that he's been saying in recent weeks and months, he told the Washington Examiner sometime mid-December that he doesn't want to see any new gun control. There's plenty of gun laws on the books, and they just need to be fully enforced. Now, if that's the guy that's protecting our liberty, I think we're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, that's what one of the frustrations I have with groups like the NRA is, because it's this milquetoast kind of reasoning. Well, we just want the existing ones. I mean, we already have gun laws, guys. We don't need new ones. And they kind of just gloss right over the fact that they just said, we're okay with the ones that exist. And I've heard you discuss what, you know, it's like, well, we want the guns out of the hands of criminals. Well, yeah, but think of how many laws we have now that effectively make someone a criminal when he shouldn't be one at all.
Yeah. I mean, most of the laws that are on the books, and again, we're talking about laws again, most of the laws on the books shouldn't exist in the first place. So many people with maybe a criminal record, a felony, a nonviolent drug charge, now they're prohibited from defending their own lives, their family, their property forever. I mean, there's no justice in that. You know, let's say drug prohibition is okay. It's not. Let's say it's okay. Once they've done the time in prison, why should they not be able to be part of society once again? The crime isn't owning something. It's what you do with it. So the idea that you need gun laws to stop drug dealers is absurd. If there's plenty of drug laws on the books already, and obviously those aren't working, so maybe there's a different problem.
Yeah, well put. Red flag laws are always in the news nowadays. For those listening who aren't quite clear on what those are, can you talk about that real quick and the problem with red flag laws?
I think Donald Trump put it best, where he said, take the guns first and due process later, because he's fully in favor of a red flag law. They use people's fear of someone being ill or in maybe going crazy and shooting people up as an excuse to get a foot in the door to find new ways to actually take firearms from people who already have them. A red flag law is something where they're basically making a determination that someone is not mentally stable or capable to keep a firearm. And I just can't imagine something like that not being abused. One only needs to look at the history of the IRS and the income tax, where they told us it was was going to be a temporary wartime measure for just the richest of the rich. And what do we have today? The Patriot Act was only going to be used to get the terrorists. So every time they tell you it's just going to be used for something, if you're okay with that, you better be certain that you're okay with them expanding that year in and year out and decade out. Because sometime in the future, someone's going to wonder why, well, why do they have the power to take guns from people who maybe hold the wrong political position? Well, that's how it starts.
You guys are all over this stuff. I know on nullification movements and local governance over federal governance. What's the most effective way that you guys have found to fight this continuing push for more gun control?
Man, I think the first is a recognition that the right to keep and bear arms is a natural right. If we're talking about education, we have to educate people that all gun control is bad, not some, because once you give them an inch, government will always take a mile or 1,000 miles or far, far more. So you have to actually start at the root cause. All gun control is a violation of the individual right to keep and bear arms. And then, man, it's tough because there's so much and there's so many problems. But I honestly think the best approach is to take the low-hanging fruit. And the easiest thing to nullify is federal gun control. Easy peasy if people are willing to do it. And the reason is that the federal ATF, and the last time I looked, they have somewhere around 5,100 to 5,500 employees for the entire country. That's their entire workforce. It may be a little bit higher now because Trump likes ramping everything up. And about a third of those are in administration, pencil pushers. So let's say I went to government school, so my math is bad. What is that? About 3,500 enforcement agents, I would guess. And their capacity year in and year out is to close somewhere between 8 and 10,000 cases per year on the federal level. Think of it this way. If there were 10 or 11 million undocumented short-barreled shotguns in existence, all in violation of the National Firearms Act of 1934, there'd be no way for the federal government to be able to stop them. Zero chance. I mean, they'd stop people here and there, maybe a few thousand. But the overwhelming numbers problem that the federal government has is a huge Achilles heel. And once you establish that as a foundation, then I think people can learn, wow, the world doesn't come to an end when people legalize on a state, local, and individual level that which the federal government prohibits, similar to the strategy that we've seen implemented by 33 states on a plant known as cannabis.
Yeah, very. Yeah, exactly. My friend Jose Nino, I'm not sure if you guys have met.
Jose's awesome.
He is.
I love Jose. Yes. Well,
one of the things that's kind of disappointed me that he's taught me is, in his work in the gun movement, that he's a lot of Republicans are really bad on this, and they kind of play up this whole, you know, Second Amendment right deal while they're trying to get elected, and then they basically go and make these backroom deals once they are elected. I assume you've ran into that many times. Who's actually been really good on the gun rights issue as far as politicians go?
I don't like politicians.
Yeah, same.
I mean, you put me in a place where I'd have to answer a question and pretend to like someone. I think they all suck. And I think if we watch them all with a jealous eye, even if they're doing something we think is good, we should never trust that they're going to be good tomorrow. They could do the best thing today, and tomorrow we should expect them to be evil monsters. And if we have that approach with politicians, I think we'll be in a much healthier, much safer, much freer society. Someone who I think has been horrible is Donald J. Trump. He has campaigned as the Second Amendment president the first time around. Now he's repeatedly talking about himself loving the Second Amendment, never doing anything to hurt it. Of course, we already talked about the bump stock ban, but we can also look at the ATF enforcement statistics. They release their annual report every year, sometime March through May. So we don't have any numbers for 2019 yet. But the last year's report, we actually learned that Donald Trump did more federal gun control enforcement actions than anyone in history. So I think there's a case to be made that the so-called Second Amendment president, endorsed by the NRA, is the worst on the Second Amendment in the history of the country, worse than Obama. And he specifically bragged about it after one of the shootings. I can't remember if it was August or September 5th of 2019. His speech, you can find it on the White House press website in their press releases. He specifically said, you know, on my direction, we banned bump stocks And we've done more federal enforcement actions, a record number in history. This is not good. And if people think that the way to protect the right to keep and bear arms is to vote for Republican over Democrat or Democrat over Republican, they've got another thing coming. In a weird way, and I can't find really either party anything to really kind of be on board with on a national level. In a weird way, though, your right to keep and bear arms is less at risk when the gun-grabbing Democrats are in there, because the Republicans actually pretend to be opposition and they stop stuff once in a while. When you got a guy like Trump in there, everyone turns a blind eye. There's no problem with this stuff, it seems like, because I think people would be going nuts. And in fact, they did. When Obama was in office, he proposed using basically the same kind of executive approach that Trump did on the bump stock ban, and people went nuts on M855 ammo, and he wasn't able to get it through. And that's an example, one example. It's anecdotal. Maybe it wouldn't happen all the time, but it is a real-life example of how two different presidents from two different parties tried the exact same approach, and when the Democrat did it, there was actual resistance which stopped it. But when the Republican did it, it's gone through.
That's interesting. It's like the
Scary, man.
I know, the Tea Party movement. These anti-taxation Republicans were so strong when Obama was in the White House, and they didn't want deficits and all this stuff. And they seem to be a little bit quieter now.
Ted Cruz was willing to shut the government down. I mean, a fake shutdown, but Ted Cruz was willing to shut the government down over funding Obamacare when Obama was in office. With Trump in office, as he had someone challenging him from the left, he voted to fund it.
Yeah.
I mean, we have countless examples of this. And I think that this shows us that there is no advancing liberty in Washington, D.C. If we look to the Constitution, whether you love it or hate it, I think the guy you want to look to for advice is probably someone like James Madison. And in a paper called Federalist 46, James Madison gave us a four-step plan on how to undermine and defeat federal programs, whether constitutional, bad policy, or seen as unconstitutional. And one of the most important ones in the four steps was a refusal to cooperate with officers of the union. His words, not mine. So if you want to defeat the federal government, you want to defeat unconstitutional acts, attacks on your liberty, you actually have to stop complying with them. And I think that's one of the big problems in the gun rights community. Sooner or later, and I saw Cliff Maloney, who I like, who heads up Young Americans for Liberty, he had posted a tweet the other day, and I'm not trying to say anything negative about Cliff because I like him and I think he does really good stuff, but he repeated something that I think is very commonly put out there, like, you know, something about, you know, law-abiding gun owners should never have their rights attacked, something like that. It was probably better than how I'm saying it. But my response to Cliff was, you know, sooner or later, if you want to keep your right to keep and bear arms, you want to protect it, you're going to have to stop being law-abiding, because as long as you continue to obey them, there's no reason for them to change the law or get rid of it.
Well, that sounds like a perfect spot to wrap here. That was well put, Michael. What do you guys got coming up at the 10th Amendment Center? I believe it was around March last year, I did an interview with Mike Meharry, and he, just as he had put out the state of the nullification report. Is that coming out soon?
Yeah, so probably sometime around March or so. We have last year's version up. It doesn't change much over the year. If you want a link for that, it's 10thamendmentcenter.com/report. This is an 80-page free download. I think I'm going to do a print version as well for people who want a print version. There's some people who still like to have paper in their hands, not me, but some people like that. And it's 80 pages. And the first half of it, 40 or so, maybe 30 pages, really kind of goes over the strategy, the foundational structure, the law, even the Supreme Court cases from 1842 to 2018 that back up this strategy of refusing to participate in the enforcement of federal acts, and explains all that in detail. So you could just read an old one now and get a lot of information. Then the second half shows how we're implementing these strategies right now. And we can talk about it in regards to surveillance, asset forfeiture, the drug war, the right to keep and bear arms, healthcare, all kinds of stuff. And so again, that's 10thamendmentcenter.com/report. We'll be updating it with the most recent information sometime in the next few months, but the current edition is still very, I think, very helpful.
Yes, yes. Well put. Michael Bolden, the 10th Amendment Center is great. And I thank you for doing what you do over there. And thank you so much for being here on Death to Tyrants.
It's such an awesome, I know I told you that in email, but I love the name of your podcast, man. So I appreciate you having me on, Buck.
You got it. Okay, you guys, I hope you enjoyed that interview with Michael Bolden. I can genuinely say that was one of the coolest, nicest guys I've interviewed. Obviously, you heard his great personality on air, but he was super cool off air as well. I'm glad we finally got to meet. It's been way too long, and I'm honored that you did the show, Michael. Thank you so much. For you guys, if you're thinking about joining the Libertarian Party, just do it, okay? We're making this large push from within to make the Libertarian Party libertarian again. And if you'd like to join, I've got a link for you. Here at Death to Tyrants, we have a link to join the LP, and that is www.lp.org/deathtotyrants. And you pretty much know this already. You found me on Facebook. If you haven't, go find me. It's facebook.com/deathtotyrantspodcast. You can follow me on Twitter at Buck Rebel, BUCKREBEL. Donate to this show if you are so inclined, and that is at patreon.com/deathtotyrants. I think that's about all the advertising for myself I've got to do. Oh, you know what? Go to iTunes and leave us a rating and a review. It's fun to see those on there. I sincerely enjoy it. And thank you guys who have done just that. Until next week, you guys have an awesome week. I'll see you soon.
You get split in fucking half, till I call him the hologram brass. But I am the center inside the placenta of math. You clash with cyanide gas and die fast. Rhythmical equivalent of solids, liquid and gas. We smash your sinus with the power of Lord Titus. But I am the virus inside of the iris of Cyrus.
Like the sound of the Death to Tyrants podcast? Our audio production is provided by Podsworth Media. Check them out at podsworth.com.